Okay, now let's go to the second set of clips right here from the Book of Jubilees, Metzaf Kufale. And now here we are in, I think this is chapter, let's scroll to the top. This is chapter, let's see, this is chapter 23. And there's a footnote, down here, but let's go to the previous page right here. Now, one thing the author, the translator here, attempts to do, he attempts to put everything within the context of Maccabees. In other words, they're trying to make all of this pre-Christ. You understand? Even though it's pre-Jesus, Yeshua, the son of the woman, because he is the son of the woman, while Christ even himself points to the son of man, the son of man coming forward, and he likens the son of man to the fatherhood of God. Now, here in the footnote down here, let's see, it says right here, it says, this was to be one of the signs, as in our text, which foreshadowed the coming of the kingdom, according to the sublime oracles. But down here it says, verses 26, we're going to go to verse 26 in the text, 230. So we start with verse 26. It says, and in those days, the children will begin to study laws, or the law, Torah, as we are doing, and to seek the commandments, and to return to the paths of a tzaddik, or the tzaddik, the righteousness. Verse 27, and the days will begin to grow many and increase among those children of men. Now, the note down here, as we just touched on, the renewed study of the law, or Torah, which is followed by a change for the better, and the gradual approach to, now note this, it didn't say the Messiah, but messianic blessedness, what we call Christian blessedness today, with this spiritual transformation of Israel. So the key really is our spiritual transformation. It says that there will take place a corresponding, and we have to go to the next page, a corresponding transformation. It's going to speak about a corresponding transformation right here of the heaven and the earth. See Revelation, the new heavens, new earth. Now, the idea also appears in Isaiah LXV or 65, verse 17. And it says, this is their final renewal. Now, in verse 27, nigh to 1,000 years. In the messianic kingdom, men will attain to the age originally designed for them by God. Adam did not attain to 1,000 years because of his chatiyat, or his sin. Now, it goes on to also mention some very interesting things concerning the messianic kingdom, where it says the writer appears to have Isaiah 65 and 20, or LXV point 20, before him, but avoids making any reference to the presence of the wicked in the consummated kingdom, as is done in Isaiah. Yet apparently they are presupposed in verse 30, though according to verse 29, there are none such. They are what? The wicked are gradually eliminated. Remember, the kingdom comes gradually. The policy of His Majesty was gradual. Then it says down here, no Satan, blessing and healing. And it's from this note on 30. It says, if this verse refers to the resurrection, the righteous are raised to share in this, and in parentheses you can clearly see they have temporary question mark, messianic kingdom. So say, if this verse refers to the resurrection, the righteous are raised to share in this temporary messianic kingdom was the kingdom of the King of Kings. Part of that temporariness of the gradual messianic kingdom, but a part of that temporary messianic kingdom. If verse 11 is correctly handed down and to be taken literally, it follows that the final judgment precedes the messianic kingdom, but the nature of this kingdom precludes such a view. It is to be introduced gradually or pari passu with the spiritual transformation of man. In other words, the messianic kingdom, it is to go hand in hand with the spiritual transformation of I, of mankind. Such a man and mankind, such a gradual and a progressive transformation does not admit of insertion of the final judgment at any single point of its evolution. So in other words, instead of people looking for like the judgment of Babylon or Babylon got to fall, they should be working on their spiritual, you understand, transformation. As it says, do not be conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Nor is there a hint of a judgment. We found this to be particularly interesting. A judgment in, let's go to the top, verses 23 to 27. Hence, the final judgment can occur only at the close of this kingdom. So the messianic kingdom closes, right? It's a gradual kingdom. It closes, and then the final judgment can only occur at the close of this kingdom. Hence, 74, 75, question mark. The kingdom is therefore of temporary duration, a conclusion which presents some difficulty, the translator R.H. Charles says right here, in face of chapter 1, verses 17, 18, and 29, but which agrees best with all other passages referring to the final judgment in this book, in the book of Jubilees, or Metzhafe Kufale. In that case, the resurrection of the Tzadikon, the righteous, and the final judgment are disjoint. You see, we've been led to believe that these two things are joined together, the final judgment and the resurrection of the righteous. But the Ethiopic Book of Enoch, you understand, it gives a clearer view and another view than what we've been told, and we know that the first century apostles had the books of Enoch and the book of Jubilees, because there are many, we'll go through that in another vid, there are many quotes where you'll see the King James New Testament Bible quotes, and you'll see where from Enoch and from Jubilee this was drawn from. So that means that the writers or the first century Christians must have had the book of Jubilees and the book of Enoch as part of their scriptures, which they referred to. So we have to go to the source material, which we now know is Ethiopic. Now, if this verse asserts that the righteous, the Tzadikon, rise to share in the kingdom, the eschatology of our author would thus differ alike, saying, from that of Ethiopic Enoch in this particular chapter here, and the testament of Judah and Simeon and Zebulun and Benjamin, where the final judgment precedes the kingdom, and the righteous are raised to enjoy it forever, and from that of the Ethiopic Enoch, where we have XCI or 91 and CIV 104, which was roughly, some say, 104 to 95 B.C., where the final judgment comes in at the close of the kingdom, and the righteous are not raised to share in it, but in a blessed immortality. Thus, the Rastafari, I and I die, in the King of Kings and in his Christ. But the teaching of our text agrees rather with that of the Ethiopic Enoch, XCI 91 to CIV 104, for the words, quote, will rise up, end quote, have apparently no reference to the resurrection and mean merely that when God heals his servants, according to Revelation, they quote Revelation 22:2, which is the end of the book, they become strong. The clauses in verse 29, quote, all their days will be days of blessing and healing. And in 129, quote, for healing for all the elect of Israel, all of the Cheruyan of Israel, all of the elect of Israel, render this view the most probable. In this case, there is no resurrection to this temporary messianic kingdom. And thus, the eschatology harmonizes perfectly with that of Ethiopic Enoch 91-104. Now, I know that was a lot right there to, you know, you have to probably go over it. Probably you could find this book for a free download on the Google if you into looking at it on computer, or hopefully purchase a copy of it if need be. But the important thing is that after all of that explanation, the author basically shows that even though these views may differ with what is commonly thought, in the full and the final analysis of the matter, it both agrees with Revelation, with the Bible, and with its other like sources when taken into complete and into full context. Now, our next little portion right here, it says, and this is on 185, there's a footnote on this page, 185, which is actually, what chapter are we in? I think we're in chapter 32 or so. And down here at the bottom, it says something about the Messiah and the Messianic Kingdom. Verses 18 to 19, it says, in the note on verse 15, we saw that according to the testament of Levi 8, the three great offices held in turn by the descendants of Levi were to be signs of the coming Messiah, who was to spring from Levi or from Judah or from Judah and Levi combined. And they put a question mark right there. Thus, according to Levi 18, Reuben 6, the Messiah, and then they put in parentheses a Maccabean priest king, question mark, or perhaps an Ethiopian Hebrew king of kings, was to spring from Levi and to be the eternal high priest and civil ruler of the nation. During his reign, it says that sin was gradually, there's that word again, gradually to come to an end, just as our author, the author of the book of Jubilee, supposes. And this is where we were in 23 verses 26 to 30. The gates of paradise to be opened, and the saints or the kedushan to eat of the tree of life, the kana bosom, as in Ethiopic Enoch 25 XXV and 5, XXV point 5 or 25 and 5. In the eternal messianic kingdom on earth, as in Ethiopic Enoch XC point 29 to 38 or 90, chapter 90 verses 29 to 38. Now, in Judah 24 to 25 and Daniel 5, the Messiah is to spring not from Levi, but from Judah, as in and according to the Ethiopic Enoch XC or chapter 90. Then it says also see the articles on the Testament of the 12 Patriarchs and in Bible Dictionary Volume 4. It is very probable that this last view underlies our text. In other words, this last view is what is really important about the Metaphic Kufale. The words, quote, a prince, dot, 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 thou and thy sons, end quote, admit most naturally of this interpretation. If this is right, then the Messiah is to spring from Judah in a kingdom which attains to realization only gradually. There's that word again, gradually. And what's interesting is in the Pearl Majesty autobiography, since Enoch Music had brought this up, and we give thanks and praise to King Kings and Christ for the brother and all the subscribers, you know, bringing forward, you know, that which is positive and fruitful. But what Enoch brought forward right there, because when we see this word gradually and we look at His Majesty's autobiography, we see that in His Imperial Majesty's autobiography, one of the first things that he speaks about is what is meant. He describes what is meant by gradually. And it seems as though R.H. Charles, in his translation and his footnotes to the Book of Enoch, the Ethiopic Book of Enoch, it keeps, in all the quotes that we've gone through, connected with the Messiah and the Messianic Kingdom, we keep seeing this word gradually. So it says, see notes on I.29 or chapter 129, XXIII, or 23 verses 26 to 30, and not catastrophically. No role seems to be assigned to him, as is also the case in Ethiopic Enoch X and C. Now, this is very, very interesting, because here we're learning, first of all, that according to the Book of Jubilees, the Messiah, first of all, is to spring from Judah. Now, this also agrees with what we know of the King James and the present, you know, Bibles that we know, the 66 or so books, that the Messiah is to spring from Judah. We find that throughout Scripture, Old Testament, and the Book of Hebrews. But now it says, in a kingdom which attains to realization, what? Only gradually. His Imperial Majesty, you know what I'm saying, from that seed, that bloodline, and being of that spiritual virtue and value, also speaks of gradually. And not, as we're told by counterfeit Christianity, catastrophically. You understand? But here's what's interesting. They say that no role seems to be assigned to him. When people say, well, where is Haile Selassie now? He already fulfilled and did what he had to do. Now, we have to do what we have to do. Now, the fact that there is no role assigned to him after this point, you understand, of establishment, you understand, and manifestation as the Ancient of Days, this agrees with also Ethiopic Enoch chapter 90. Now, the author here says, on the other hand, this seems to be the earliest instance of the presence of a Messiah or a Christ or an anointed in a temporary messianic kingdom. A temporary messianic kingdom, or a Davidic Hebrew kingdom, and this is what we have in the example of the King of Kings of Ethiopia and Ethiopia. And here it says, see note on 23 and 30, and we had already basically gone there from the earlier part of this reasoning. So this is just some of what we wanted to share a little bit, and there's more. This is just the Book of Enoch. I mean, this is the Book of Jubilees. We didn't get into the Book of Enoch just yet, but this is from the Book of Jubilees, or the little Genesis, the one translated from the editor's Ethiopic text and edited with introduction notes and indices by R.H. Charles, D.D., Professor of Biblical Greek, Trinity College, Dublin. And this was a work which was produced in London, 1902, by Adam and Charles Black. So give thanks.